Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Wilfried Eckstein. I'm the director of the Goethe-Institut, and I have the honor to welcome you also on behalf of NYU and the European colleagues and our panel. I welcome you to the fifth panel in the series Iconoclash. The series is an inquiry into the cultural and value systems which fuel terrorism and the international threat posed by extremists with an Islamic background. We are all witnesses of the conflict. We probably have all taken sides, and we share the hope that the terrorists must be overcome. But to be really successful in this endeavor, it's not enough to send drones to equip with armors and maybe to send your own troops. But for us, the people from the cultural fields, like me and my colleagues here, we assume that we can only be successful if we don't fail to understand the ideological background which motivates ISIS and which works like a magnet throughout the Islamic world to attract followers. To understand that cultural background behind the success of the terrorists has been the motivation behind organizing the series Iconoclash. Today's panel has the title Destruction as Image Act, Remapping History. We want to look at the ongoing picture war, which is a calculated and successful use of imagery and of formats such as documentary film, feature film, and video games. We want to look at the terrorist strategy of remapping geopolitics and imprinting new marks on the calendar of world history with dates such as 9/11 in the US and January 7th and Friday, November 13, 2015 in Paris. The panel under the series title Iconoclash is an inquiry into the cultural and value systems. We want to better understand the cultural complexity that has brought forward the ongoing and spreading terrorist threat. This panel and the whole series has been supported by the EU delegation to the United States, the British Council, the Austrian Cultural Forum, the embassies of Belgium, Slovenia, and Sweden. This particular event has been made possible by the Embassy of Sweden and the Austrian Cultural Forum, and I see my colleague here, and thank you to you personally. On behalf of all my European partners, I would like to express my deep gratitude to the New York University and the Brademer Center in particular, cooperating with us in this program. Thank you also to the technical staff who is recording this event and will make it available online. We have been embraced by NYU's hospitality, and we are very grateful. For today's panel, dear members of the audience, four experts were willing to join our invitation. Their biographies and their continuous study of the cultures and media of the Middle East can help us to better understand what is going on and our role therein. Their knowledge of languages and cultures and media of the Middle East will enlighten us and provide us with a better understanding of what is going on around us. Maybe we even discover what it needs to bring the conflict to a successful end. Ladies and gentlemen, please allow me to introduce the four panelists. To my left and to your middle, Ms. Hani Al-Sayed is the host and MC of tonight's panel. After the outbreak of the Syrian uprising, Ms. Al-Sayed came to the United States. She co-founded Suryali, an independent non-profit online radio station, where she works as media consultant, host, and producer. She also was co-founder and is co-founder of Roya Association, which is translated into Vision for a Better Syria. She was part of the Spark Media team, which won the Best Documentary Feature Peer Gold and Acolyte Awards for Red Lines. Red Lines is a film which was produced in 2014 and tells about the Syrian revolution. This film still receives awards until today. She also works as a development manager at El Hibri Foundation, which supports peace education and interfaith cooperation. She teaches presently as adjunct professor at the School of Foreign Service at Georgetown University, where she created a course titled Media, Arts, and Culture, Fueling War or Creating Peace? For her efforts to promote a better future for Syria, she was awarded an Alumni Achievement Award by the Lebanese American University. Ms. Al-Sayed is a graduate of the Fletcher School of Law and Diplomacy at Tufts University in the Global Arts Master Program, and she will lead our discussion tonight. The next lady I would like to introduce is Nadia Oweidat. She's senior non-residential fellow at the New America Foundation. She also teaches modern Islamic thought and extremism at Georgetown. Born and raised in Jordan, Nadia Oweidat holds a BA in English literature from the University of Jordan, an MA in international studies from the University of Wyoming, and a PhD from the University of Oxford, where she was also awarded the prestigious Weidenfeld Leadership Scholarship. Her doctoral research illuminates currents of Islamic thought and the challenges facing reformers who work from within the tradition. Prior to her doctoral studies, she worked as research associate at the RAND Corporation, where she initiated research and analysis of Arabic cultural material that promotes critical thinking. Nadia Oweidat's expertise spans a wide range of contemporary issues such as the Arab Spring, countering violent extremism, the radicalization of Muslim youth, and internet trends among Arabic speakers. She's board member at the International Center for Religion and Diplomacy, on the advisory board of the American Leadership Alliance, and she has received awards for her work and often is asked for interviews and for comments on Arabic and Muslim issues in media networks such as the National Public Radio, CNN, BBC, France 24, and more. Let me now come to the gentlemen on the panel. They have come all the way from Europe, so but they are fresh. So Christian Christensen here is professor of journalism at the Department of Media Studies at Stockholm University. This is why we have the Swedish flag here. How's that? He's American. He focuses his research upon the relationship between media and power, in particular during times of warfare. He looks at the representation of Islam in the international media and the use of social media for information distribution. He has written numerous articles, books, chapters, and mainstream media opinion pieces on the WikiLeaks whistleblowing organization and was the editor of WikiLeaks From Political Economy to Popular Culture. That was the article. He's currently a member of the large-scale research project Media, Conflict, and Democratization, funded by the European Union, in which the role of information communication technologies in political and social conflicts are analyzed. Thank you for being here. Last but not least, Rüdiger Lohlker. He has come all the way from Austria. He is professor of Islamic studies in the Oriental Institute at the University of Vienna, Austria. Due to international political circumstances, I would say, he has become an expert on the radicalization in the Islamic world. He speaks more than a dozen languages, from Spanish to Russian, Turkish, and of course Farsi and Arabic. In his research, he looks at the history of Islamic ideas, at the Islam and the Arab world online, modern Islamic movements, jihadism, and Islamic law. He focuses on Arab and Islamic websites and contemporary Islamic movements like jihadism and Salafism. He maintains several blogs about Islam and Arabian culture, critique of anti-Muslim discourses, and Arab hacker culture. He wrote about topics such as tonight's the role of pictures in social media. His practical educational work includes teaching imams and mosque activists. Previous to his present position at Vienna, he taught at the universities of Gießen, Göttingen, and Kiel in Germany, worked at the state and university libraries of Lower Saxony and Göttingen, as well as the Bibliothèque Générale des Archives in Rabat, Morocco. For the European Union, he has been a consultant of an expert group on the topic of radicalization. Looking at the challenges deriving from extremism and terrorism has become a major professional task of his. But he's first of all a lover of books and poetry. And he confessed to me that if he had a choice, he would rather publish about gardens of the Orient than comment on ongoing picture war and terrorism. But today he's here. Rüdiger Lohlker accepted our invitation, applied for a visa. You know, it's difficult to come with such a record of being in Arab countries, and traveled here to share his knowledge and insight with all of us, together with Christian Christensen, Nadia Oweidat, and Hani Al-Sayed. Please give them a warm welcome.
Thank you, Wilfried, and thank you, everybody. Good evening. How's everybody feeling tonight? Good. Great. So I'm just going to talk a little bit about the importance of culture from a Syrian perspective. This is not to say that I represent Syria. This is just from my own perspective. I'm going to start out with a quote from Mark Twain. Mark Twain once wrote about Syria's capital, Damascus, has seen all that has ever occurred on earth, and still she lives. She has looked upon the dry bones of 1,000 empires and will see the tombs of 1,000 more before she dies. Though another claims the name, Old Damascus is the eternal city. And that's how I feel about Syria. Syria is a cradle of civilizations with history of human settlement that goes back to 5,000 years, during which Babylonians, Greeks, Romans, Byzantines, Umayyads, Ottomans have lived. And so our histories have been and will continue to be interwoven, where the us and them is a blurred line I would like to call humanity. However, Syria, the cradle of civilizations, has witnessed a revolution, an armed conflict, the use of chemical weapons, and the domination of a proxy war and Islamist radicals over diplomatic and political narratives. Syrians have been robbed from their freedom, their dignity, and their lives. War has resulted in considerable damage, not only to Syrian souls, but also destruction, looting, and illicit trade to Syria's heritage. And so robbing Syrians of their identity too. History is the foundation of Syria's diversity, economy, and culture. It's our heritage that tells our human story, and a story or a tale that has been told universally through platforms we're all familiar with. To name a few, graffiti, fashion, food, poetry, film, theater, art, music, I can keep going on. And in our day and age, social media and technology. All the variety of platforms represent and form our social and our self-identities, as well as our ideas, and all of which have been widely in motion for centuries. Throughout the world, cultural heritage is our stronghold of existence. And when our heritage is destroyed, so is our identity. As human beings without our past, we have no future. Then again, knowing Syria's culture, it is a culture of resilience. Also throughout history, when conflicts arose, and this is a fact, media and the arts flourished with them. sometimes as transformers of social behaviors and reality, other times as fuels that drive wars. In fact, during the past 6 years alone in Syria and in the diaspora, over 100 media outlets emerged. Thousands of civil society, arts, and culture initiatives emerged, finding their limited space to just express themselves, shouting out for help, documenting humanitarian violations, and with it, their cultural heritage. All this in the face of media and political narratives dehumanizing and demonizing Syrians. Which brings me to mention the nonprofit independent radio that I helped co-found, Suriali, which, Wilfried, thank you for mentioning. That was such a long bio, I felt sorry for everybody. Suriali is a double meaning, and it means surreal, as in how we feel about what's happening in Syria today. It also means Syria is mine, which is ownership. Suriali basically was launched in October of 2012. I arrived here January 2012, forced to leave Syria after almost over a decade of having my own radio show back home called Good Morning Syria, which was inspired from Good Morning Vietnam's Robin Williams, bless his soul. Like many Syrians arriving to the United States, and those who have heard me speak before, I've probably said this, and I'm probably going to continue saying it for the rest of my life. There are two things that come to mind when you arrive to a new country, when you're forced to leave and arrive to a new country, and that is, one, survival, two, the guilt of survival. And so I connected with a few friends of mine who had the same feelings and were forced to also leave Syria. I had a couple in France and one in Germany, and myself here in the United States, and after months, hours, days over Skype, that's virtually, we created Suriali and we launched it. Suriali is focused on advancing the level of awareness of Syrians on concepts that are new to us, like what is democracy, what's rule of law, what's transitional justice, and so on. Today, Suriali has 20 Syrians working virtually from all over the world and inside Syria. They all come from a rich mosaic of backgrounds, just like Syria, and with 50% women representation. By employing media, imagery, and the art of storytelling and satire, which you'll be hearing from our panelists today, Radio Suriali is also focusing on peace-building, psychosocial development, cultural preservation, and advocacy. Finally, nothing is impossible where people power is at play. Nothing is impossible when we, as people of this world, collectively persevere to sustainable solutions for justice and peace, and also banishing the misconceptions and typecasting, to build strong cultural bridges between the MENA region and the international communities. It's a challenging but worthwhile journey. With that being said, and I'm done here once I find the rest of my papers, I just want to welcome one more time Nadia, Christian, and Rudy. Thank you for allowing me to call you Rudy because I couldn't pronounce your name properly and embarrass myself. I'm delighted to be here with you today. We're going to open up the discussion with 10 to 15 minutes each with an overview of how and why conflict, killing of innocent civilians, destruction of cultural heritage, propaganda, and imagery are integral to terrorism of all kinds. What has been and what is media and the arts' role in preserving culture and forming or destroying cultural heritage? And why has the ice created that shock effect? And where and who are the counter narratives? Please, let's welcome them one more time.
Thanks. Thank you. I'd like to thank the Goethe-Institut, European Union, my semi-adopted home country of Sweden for funding this event. My mother is Swedish, my father's Danish. I grew up, I lived in Turkey, my brother's born in Japan, so this is all extremely familiar in terms of the internationalization. But my role here, I think, is perhaps a little bit different than our other panel members, I would suggest. And my role here, as I see it, is to discuss the relationship between some of the propaganda we see on social media and thinking about questions of media themselves, about journalism, and about free speech in relationship to what we might broadly term as terrorist imagery. So I'm not coming here as an expert on the Middle East. I come here as someone who spent a fair amount of his life looking at representations of warfare, representations of conflict, but also someone who spent the last several years of my career looking at social media, both in terms of mainstream politics, but also in terms of sort of radical transparency politics, as Honey was talking about, and earlier Rudy and Wilfried about WikiLeaks. But really, I've also become interested in the use of social media by these organizations. And so what I'd like to do is I'd like to maybe just start off the conversation a little bit today by contextualizing the way in which maybe we think about the images. Because I think over the last two or three years, very often social media, be it YouTube or Facebook or Twitter or Instagram, these have been the platforms through which we have seen a fair number of these extremely violent images and these acts of destruction. And it's been a fairly expert use of social media by terrorist organizations like ISIS in this. And I just wanted to talk a little bit about what this means, how we might want to think about it. And just as a beginning story, some of you may have heard that at the moment, Twitter is facing a lawsuit in San Francisco filed by the wife of a worker, an American worker in Jordan, who was killed, who was training, I believe, the police department in Jordan. And she is suing Twitter. And the basis of the lawsuit is that Twitter's platform had enabled terrorist organizations to communicate with each other, and that that, in part, had a direct relationship to her husband's death. So she has filed a suit against Twitter. And while Twitter itself is quite confident that it will win this case, it is interesting as a point of departure to think about this, that Twitter is seen in certain legal circles as a platform for this kind of information distribution. And it's also a little bit a good starting point for thinking about social media and this violent imagery. Twitter itself, it says, there's absolutely no relationship between this crime and what we have. We have a platform for information used by hundreds of millions of people, and so absolutely we have no responsibility for this act. The family, on the other hand, and the attorneys say there is a responsibility because there was not sufficient effort put in to stopping terrorist organizations from using Twitter. And that actually the logo underneath my talk here, this was a sort of an amalgam of ISIS and Twitter that is used by some of these users. Just as a starting point, it's worth thinking about the traditional, you know, representation of terrorism that we had before social media. You know, 5 million years ago, before we had Facebook and Twitter and Instagram, when we had newspapers and television. And the amount of editorial power that went in to decision-making about what images we saw and how terrorism was represented. And I think it's also very important to think about this as a beginning point of thinking about social media. History did not begin 6 years ago or 7 years ago. And here we see three very good examples, Munich Olympics, of course, the IRA bombing in Brighton with the attempt to kill Margaret Thatcher and the rest of her government, and of course, 9/11. And these notions of the spectacular, the requirement that events were of a particularly spectacular nature in order to garner the attention of the mass media. And also to think about the relationship between these kinds of events and the nature of commercial media itself, the demands of commercial media to make money, to gather the attention of people, and the knowledge on the part of terrorist organizations that this is what is required. Twitter has been very active over the last few years in deleting accounts. Most social media organizations have not been passive. YouTube, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram have all been very active in the deletion of accounts, Twitter. This is a recent article from The Guardian. There were 125,000 ISIS-related accounts were actually deleted. And I think that when we think about social media here and we think about the reaction, another point I'd like to begin to think about is that these organizations, just as with commercial organizations, news organizations, are commercial ventures. They have their own interests in terms of free speech. And so when we begin to think about free speech, we cannot see these as sort of value-neutral platforms that simply exist for the spread of information. These are companies with bottom lines, with investors who have interests. And when these accounts were suspended, death threats were issued against several leading members of the Twitter management team. And when they were confronted about this, members of the management team said, this just goes along with the territory. Now, really what I'm getting at here is a transference, in a way, of the gatekeeper function from traditional mass media in terms of terrorist images to social media. And this is a very big difference, I would argue. We have gone away from an editorial position where newspaper editors would make decisions about how to frame events, how to show them, and what not to show, to a situation where we see users spreading information outside of the control of any kind of editorial system, which is different. And we saw this in many cases over the last 6 months to a year, for example, with the beheading of James Foley and the discussion about the ethics of showing this material. And YouTube and Twitter have been very active in trying to take material down, but also what needs to be remembered is an effort to take down material. For example, YouTube has very strict terms of service about criminal activity. Anything considered to be even remotely criminal is automatically taken down. Twitter operates under slightly different rules. But as the article is another article from The Guardian, I'm just putting some newspaper headlines up here, it's not as clear-cut as it seems. And one of the reasons why it's not clear-cut is that we are the arbiters very often about what gets put up. And we are sometimes the arbiters of what gets taken down also. So when YouTube puts up material, it pops up somewhere else. And it's a cat and mouse game. And this is not simply a question of terrorists sharing information. We are sharing the very information that the terrorists put out as well. And this became the discussion, this became the free speech issue within particularly Twitter, around the Foley video and around other ISIS material. And so this is an article from Wired about why Facebook and Twitter, they can't just wipe out ISIS online, because we're talking about a multi-headed monster here, which is not simply at the control of a centralized organization. It's not as if you wipe out one or two people that you can wipe out everything. We are sharing. Then the question becomes, as far as I'm concerned as a media scholar, what is our responsibility in the spread of information? How does the question of newsworthiness come into our discussion about this information? When the Foley video came out, it wasn't simply ISIS members who were banned or cut. It was actually regular non-terrorist users whose accounts were suspended for a number of months simply for sharing the video. And then what happens then? We have accusations of censorship. So really, to me, as a media scholar, what becomes interesting here is our conception of where the lines are about where we censor, when we censor, but also who we censor and why. And so really the Foley, this is a picture of Foley that was spread quite often on Twitter in as a response to the extremely disturbing image of, you know, Foley kneeling in front of his executioner. And it really is about the rights of individuals to spread violent imagery. And of course, what we're getting to here is a core discussion about freedom of speech. And very different, I would say, between Europe and the United States. I live in a country in Sweden which has rather more restrictions on the latitude in free speech than exists in the United States. It is not quite as broad as it is in the US. And ISIS itself proved to be extremely savvy in its understanding of social media. And also, depending on your point of view, the willingness of users to be voyeuristic and to spread information simply because it was spectacular or unusual, versus the ideology of people who felt a kinship with that organization. And so I think the discussion about social media and terrorism should not simply be limited to who posts the material, but then who spreads it afterwards. And that is a far more complex question, I would argue, and a far more complex issue than simply the first one. And many on Twitter called on users to block information. Now, as a response, as we see here, Silicon Valley has approached, and here we reach another issue related to terrorism that I think is worth thinking about in broad terms, which is the relationship between government and the restriction on free speech and the ways in which government has been actively engaging with social media organizations to stop or to at least try to rid ourselves of some of the material online. Now, why this is important to me is a question of consistency. And this is like organizations like the Electronic Frontier Foundation have had this discussion where, yes, I think we can all agree that a crime online, a beheading of a family member, is outrageous and should be blocked. But then the question is, where is the line drawn in terms of criminal activity? What other terrorist organizations internationally will also be blocked? Or are we simply bracketing off a certain group, but not thinking more broadly? And then also a question of surveillance. To what point does this does the emphasis on terrorism then become the question of surveillance? And this was actually a list from the meeting between Silicon Valley and the US government about the issues that they consider to be important. How can we make it harder for terrorists to leverage the internet? How can we help others to create, publish, and amplify alternative content? In what ways can we use technology to disrupt radicalization? And how can we make it harder for terrorists to use the internet? Again, I think here, you look at this list and we think rationally, in a democratic society, these are perfectly acceptable discussions to have. And to me, that's not the problem or the issue as a researcher. To me, the issue is, what are the potential byproducts of this list that go beyond ISIS and go into other organizations in society? My last slide is Facebook's stock value, right? And I don't think we should ever forget about this when we're talking about free speech and the relationship between terrorist imagery, free speech, and censorship online. Facebook is a company that is stock-owned. It went public. Twitter is a company that is not stock-owned, but is, you know, was looking that way, but it's not looking that great for them right now, to be honest with you. But it's a company that does not answer to a single owner. It doesn't answer to Zuckerberg the same way it did before this line started. This is answering to a multitude of people whose interests might lie outside of free speech, or they might lie outside of something that we consider to be important. It might be simply a question of expedience and profit margin, which you expect from investors. But this is the same discussion that we've been having within media and communication studies about newspapers for 100 years. There's nothing new here. The problem from my perspective is, and I'm, you know, blatant self-promotion here. This is my email address and my Twitter account. But really for me, what is interesting here is that my understanding of the popular discussion of social media has very often been that the political economy of these platforms has often been drained from the discussion. The Arab Spring, Twitter revolutions, Facebook revolutions, which I've also written about in part. In these discussions, very often, from my eyes, from a researcher's eyes, we looked at these as neutral platforms that were there as tools for the people and sort of, you know, value neutral. Not that Facebook was collecting data on anybody, not that Twitter could be monitored, right? And which country in the world has had the most Twitter takedown requests granted? Turkey, where I lived for 4 years, okay? This is an increasingly authoritarian government that is using social media for monitoring. It is actively punishing people for posting material online. If you follow news from Turkey, you know that very often journalists, politicians, and individuals are charged with insulting the president, which is against the law in Turkey. And Twitter has complied. And this, what is interesting to note here as a final point is that Twitter now has, as you probably know, have changed their rules. They used to operate under the general rule that there was free speech. Now it operates on a country-by-country basis. So if you violate the laws of the country in which you are located, your material can be taken down upon request. But of course, not every country is, you know, Sweden. And I think that's the problem. When we think about these technologies, and Facebook operates under very different circumstances, and often not transparent at all about what on Facebook gets taken down or not get taken down. And so I think the theme of today's discussion and where I'm coming from as a sort of maybe as a starting point here is the extremely disturbing and violent imagery that we've seen. I think there's a consensus that this is material that should not be there, especially family members who are forced to see the killing of their own family. I don't think there's anybody who argues against that. But what happens is it opens up an extremely tricky can of worms for democratic societies to begin to discuss the lines and where they're drawn. And also that this is no longer the New York Times and the Washington Post and the BBC that are anchored in nation state. These are now multinational, international corporations, stock-owned companies, operating across the globe under very different legal regimes with very different rules about free speech. And how do we handle that new sort of complicated situation? So I just thought maybe I would open up the talk today by sort of throwing out some media-related questions on this question of image and destruction and propaganda. Thank you.
Thank you, Christian. So happy St. Patrick's Day. I don't feel so bad not wearing green. There's only one person in the entire, maybe two, three, there, four. Okay, so. But I'm not in the minority for a change. So I will be talking today about, I'll provide a context for what's happening in the Middle East, but also talk about the solution, because we talk so much about the problem. So let's talk about the solution. So the Arab world, as you know, I actually prefer to use the term Arabic speaking, because it's a very diverse region that includes Kurds, Circassians, includes a lot of different people who are not Arabs. So Arabic speaking is more respectful of these different diverse people. There are about 500 million people who speak Arabic as natives, and it's a region that boasts very high birth rates. So it has a youth bulge that is expanding and expanding, and according to the UN, will peak in 2050. So this is going nowhere. This issue of a lot of people, 80%, in fact, under 40 years old, 50% between the ages of 15 and 25. So it's a very, very young region. Most of these people go to school. It's not top-of-the-line education, but there's literacy. In fact, according to the World Bank, illiteracy is practically zero for the younger generation. Given that context of young, energetic, the Middle East is home to the biggest regional unemployment in the world. So young, unemployed, but that's not it, because this generation is so different from its parents. So it's somewhat isolated. There's always a gap between our generation and our parents, but in this particular generation, the gap is so massive, because you know, when I think of myself, what skills can my mom teach me? I mean, I've no time to cook, so computers, presentations, travel. So the skills are not transportable in many ways. And a lot of these young people live in cities where there's a lot of interaction with other people, with artists, what happened around the world is local news. This was not necessarily the case in my mother or grandparents' generation. And how they are teaching themselves is mostly actually online. So I want to also provide a context for Islamic extremism. So for a long time, before the internet, but at the beginning also of the life of the internet in the Arab world, what really was publicized, what had a lot of funding, was Islamist material. Islamist material that is really, I can argue that it's the foundation for extremism. You can't jump to extremism. You need a little bit of, we need an Islamic state, we need a caliphate, we need to renew jihad. So maybe soft, that was viewed by many regimes as benign. It's Islamic, it's okay, it's not very harmful. So there was no far vision, you know, and let me remind you that Reagan invited Taliban to the White House as freedom fighters. So they were seen as very benign. There was a lot of support financially, and it was seen as authentic, and they practically had no competition in terms of how much support
they got compared to liberals, they have a lot harder time obtaining funding and support. So these young people are quite hungry for information. And how do we know this? Look at the record of how they use social media. So the highest Facebook users in the world are in the Arab world. The highest downloaders of educational material on YouTube are in the Arab world. So there is phenomenal appetite to learn about the world. And this is coupled with an education that is practically obsolete. So if you want to learn something, you go to YouTube. And actually, women are the biggest downloaders of educational material. So this is really interesting because you can learn from home. And even my 65-year-old mother, who doesn't know English, has an iPad and learned how to consult on her cooking. And she's never worked a day in her life. So this is how rampant it has become to use the internet for education. And during the Arab Spring, there were more tweets in Arabic than any other language. And there are a lot of things that are really changing fundamentally the wiring of the region and its citizens. So smartphone penetration is rising. And again, if I may bring a little bit of a perspective, a personal perspective, even as a student, or almost, you know, a student budget, every time I get an upgrade, I would give my iPhone to an activist or a student in Jordan. And I've given at least 5 devices, including 2 Kindles. So it changes somebody's life when they have an iPhone. They really have access to all sorts of information they wouldn't otherwise. So you may think, but how many people have access to Wi-Fi? Well, according to some research in 2017, in 1 year, 1 out of every 2, basically. So this is changing a lot of things. How people, you know, when you create your own Facebook page, especially as a woman, like, you're creating your own identity. There's autonomy that is not really part of our traditional culture that is focusing on tribalism, more family, more. But the internet is all about individualism. When you hold your phone in your hand, you decide where you go. It's your own curiosity. So you have the remote control. And out of this incredible rewiring, there are a lot of healthy phenomena taking place, such as citizen journalism. So for example, in Jordan, there's a few young men and women created a blog called Hiber. So it's citizen journalism in this beautiful setting in First Circle in Amman. If any of you go to Jordan, you must visit their beautiful organic cafe downstairs. And they not only publish world-class journalism, but they also provide training for their fellow young men and women on storytelling, on investigative journalism. So they're very young and they're teaching each other. I mean, this is phenomenal. And what is happening is that there's a decentralization of power, which again is actually very healthy in the Middle East, where there was so much control before. And you know what happened in Iraq? You take the regime, everything crumbles because everything is in the hand of one man. You know, in every family, there's a monarch. So there's a decentralization of authority, and the Arab Spring really amplified this big time. There's an unleashing of creativity that is unprecedented for the region. And again, you hear a lot about terrorism and the use of social media. But actually, when I looked at what do Arabic speakers watch most on YouTube, on Facebook, what forum attracts more people than others, it was really surprising. So the most watched YouTube channels all over the Arab world, this is true for Jordan, Saudi Arabia, Morocco, Iraq, everywhere, are people who are equivalent of Jon Stewart, basically people who mock political, religious, and social authoritarianism. So they use humor and satire to basically mock. I mean, it's so brilliant. I'll show you some videos. Like one of them, for example, attracted 97 million. I mean, so they vary. There's a lot of creativity everywhere. Some of them thousands or hundreds of thousands. But it's really a beautiful terrain that nobody's paying attention to, practically. So if you look at Facebook the top 150 most followed Facebook pages are not religious content, actually. So it's not Islamic content. And if you compare Ahlam Mustaghanmi, she's an Algerian author. She posts things about reform. She has she's one of the best-selling authors. You know, we all share one language, and we share a lot of cultural things, including authoritarianism. So her novels are about the authoritarianism of both the Islamist and the so-called secular regimes, and how they both couldn't care less about the people. So her Facebook page has over 8 million followers, dedicated followers. She would post something, 100,000 people are commenting or sharing. And the Muslim Brotherhood, the biggest Islamist party, has less than two. And it really shows you, you know, speaking of, so the Muslim Brotherhood did this experiment, not an experiment, they actually wanted their young recruits to use their version of Facebook. So they created a version of Facebook, looks exactly like Facebook, the same color, everything, but it's monitored. It flunked, nobody watched it, nobody engaged with it. So even within their own recruits, they're like, well, I could have the real Facebook where I have some autonomy, or I could be watched by my supervisor, et cetera. So it's very telling. So there's a phenomenal opportunity here. There are a lot of people using their agency and using it to do well, to educate one another, to really root the very values that gave birth to human rights, universal human rights. And really, their vision for their societies is very refreshing and very based on non-violent communication. It's a vision where coercion, intimidation, and violence are not okay mechanisms of exerting influence. And this is really what I focus on, and I'm going to be writing a book, actually, on this for the next 12 months. I will be a residential fellow at New America. And peer learning is so phenomenal because, again, these kids are more likely and are learning from one another. I say kids are in their 20s and 30s, so, but then they are likely to learn from schools, from teachers, and there's research indicating that young people would rather be online than be watching state media, which is amazing. That's really good. And or even spending time with their families. Again, it's really activating a wiring that encourages curiosity, encourages, especially given what they go to watch, is quite optimistic, promising, sorry. So in terms of forums, this is a leading forum. It's called the Civilized Debate. It actually, it's so horribly disorganized, and it's jammed. There's 25,000 writers, and they range from professors, academics, thinkers, philosophers, to people who are intellectuals or young men and women who are self-educating themselves on issues such as culture, such as religion, history. Number one issue is separation between religion and politics. So there's a genuine voice seeking secularism in a context of the Middle East where religion is not used to abuse people's rights. And they have 3 million people debating. So again, what ISIS platform has that amount of vibrancy? We sometimes forget that there's another side that needs some help also. So the unleashing of creativity that happened in the Arab world, I want to share with you some cartoons because cartoons can tell a story in one picture. And I want to emphasize that this revolution, this creativity spring, is taking place everywhere, in Yemen, in Sudan. It's really amazing, the places and the creativity that exist. So this is from Jordan. It's called Confrontation. It embodies, basically, what is happening. This is by a woman cartoonist from Egypt. Her name is Dua. She's very, it's very powerful. Like, again, talk about agency. Are we creating these dictators? There's a lot of literature taking on ISIS, making fun of ISIS. I can relate to this one. So raising women's status, Arab style, you know, like there's the woman is upside down and tied and, hey, we're raising your status. This is from Yemen. Again, a lot of us who want to be productive part of our communities are having to go away, to leave. There's no space for somebody who thinks and wants to contribute. And look at the man, he has his book. I mean, it's loaded with symbolism. I have never seen so many cartoons in my life. It's like a revolution in cartoons, you know? This is actually a Sudanese cartoonist. Oh, freedom of speech. Is using social media from under the ground. So, freedom of speech is buried, right, under a military regime, but it's tweeting from underneath the ground. So it's not only cartoons, actually. There are also videos, music. I want to show you a song. And look at the translation of the words, because it's very powerful. It expresses the sentiments of a whole generation of young people. I'm almost done, but I really have to show you. Have you seen No Woman, No Drive? I'll just show you a few seconds of it. Because I have other videos that people don't usually know about. But you know, like the words, I'm not going to be a copy like you, and I want to do something with my life, but not how you want it, not in the past. And these sentiments express a whole sentiment of a whole generation.
Hello, my name is Hisham Figi. I'm an artist and social activist. I don't really listen to music, but while studying in the US, I heard a song by a Jamaican guy that really caught my attention. I decided to do my own rendition, with lyrics relevant to my culture, but without musical instruments.
I forget.
And now, with the help of some of my help.
Sorry, I forgot to tell you, show you, and the other song. Within a few days, he had 4 million viewers. He now has 65 million. This is mocking, like, as you know. I mean, I'll let you watch it at home, but you get the point. He has 13 million. I want to show you, oops. Also in poetry, this is a Palestinian woman. I'm almost done, I promise. I'm abusing the podium. I'm here, I'm gonna stay in power. Again, the words are so powerful. So again, I am happy to send links of these and others. And since I took too much time, I will we'll just go to questions for later. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Nadia. Yes.
So I would love to continue. Much too interesting than whatever I can say. But nevertheless, to quote it, what's left from to me to say about it. I think I should talk a little bit about ISIS and jihadism, and especially cultural heritage and destruction of cultural heritage. But two remarks to presentations. I would like one of my former students, who was running a Twitter account called Online Jihad, researching on online jihad. His account was deleted. quite successful, evidently. And another one, it's in this civilized discussion blog side. I remember one course I was reading last winter term, and my students asked me, I don't find anything there. There's too much. So disorganized. I don't know where to begin. And so we tried to map this site. Quite difficult enterprise to do. Okay, but coming back to ISIS, if we are talking about ISIS, and we are often forgetting ISIS is living, acting in a certain framework, and that's the framework of colonialism. It's still a colonial situation, framework they are working in, and I'm skipping this talk about post-colonialism since I'm an academic. I might say it's pure academic play of words. Forget about it, it's colonialism pure. It's a kind of imagining itself, what ISIS is doing, as the one and only actor able to topple the system of colonialism. The only ones who are fighting colonialism, nobody else is doing, not the Arab regimes who are telling for decades, no, we are fighting colonialism, no. ISIS is saying, no, they never did. We are doing it. They don't even know about what you have been telling us about. It's the post-colonial situation of the Arab world. ISIS is part of the old system of the Arab world. It's not the future. It's the past that's striving to survive. As a symbol, we might think of this, this discussion of the Sykes-Picot treaty, the abolishment of abolishing the borders between Iraq and Syria, etc., etc. So it's I would like to say ISIS is built upon the ruins of the former nationalist regimes. They are built on the ruins of the Ba'ath regimes, okay, and Syria is still existing in some parts of Syria. Iraq doesn't exist anymore. Think of Gaddafi, etc. All these nationalist regimes created the idea of a pure national identity constituted in the fight and the combat with the West, whatever it is. It's quite going back to that time. And they are built upon the idea of a homogeneous Islam, going back to the time of the so-called modernists of the 19th century, that were creating the idea we do have an international, transnational, homogeneous Islam that's standing against the West, that's different from the West. And we have to build it up as a force globally. And it's built... They are built upon the idea of fighting colonialism, even when they are not doing it. Even Wahhabism, we might not think of a nationalist regime or anti-colonial regime. They are built on the experience of 19th century colonialism in Western Africa and in South Asia, not in the Arab world, in the Arab Peninsula. The Wahhabi scholars were learning from West African scholars. They were learning from South Asian scholars, since they were aware, okay, we don't know, really don't know what's happening now, and we are not very good scholars concerning certain Islamic disciplines. There is another misconception that we often hear in the debate about ISIS, that's about modernity. They are fighting modernity, that's true. For sure, Western modernity, but they are doing it in terms of modernity. It's quite a paradox, for sure, but it's ISIS and the other Al-Qaeda, etc. The other groups are fighting Western modernities, but they are living in a form of modernity, maybe a barbarian one, okay? But modernity, as we know, has had and still has its dark sides. They are not appropriating modernity, so that's thanks to Christian. that would introduce a kind of dichotomy between us, who have created this good, beautiful modernity, etc., and these guys are getting it, trying to rob us from our modernity. No, they are living in a kind of modernity, a cruel form. Sure, they are mirroring the West in certain ways. Be it symbolically, think about if you're looking into films, and not only the Foley videos, but all of the films produced by ISIS, you might see there are many parts of films, Hollywood films, Eastern films, etc., cut into it. There are other elements of Westernized and Easternized popular culture in it. So it's quite a modern way of looking into the world, and they are doing it practically, not only symbolically. There are some videos out now by ISIS that they are, what are you seeing? we are seeing videos from the perspective of a drone circulating above a certain location to be attacked, zooming in, and then it's all is blown up. You know, all of you know these images of drone attacks anywhere, but ISIS is using it. It's this imaginary. The third misconception, I think, is that ISIS is, to a certain extent, not Islamic, nor religious, not at all. It's nihilistic or whatever. Academics have coined many, many, many words to describe this situation. I think they are, if we are following the sources, we might say ISIS, as they are busy creating their own version of Islam, their own variety of Islam, an ISIS Islam. They are putting an enormous effort into producing this kind of Islam. Megabytes and megabytes or so. I checked, sorry for the Austrian embassy this morning, some Telegram accounts, and it was about 25,000 posts the last 3 days. So imagine this energy put into it, producing this kind of Islam. They are writing theological tracts, fatwas, short texts on every issue, Islamic issue you may think of. They are adopting it. It's in the form of videos, public meetings, newsletters, even slogans, whatever, simple slogans, trying to convey the idea in a very coherent form. There is a pure Islam emerging now, and we are bringing it to life. That's behind it. These steps, this effort, tap into many aspects of the modern Islam, so we have heard about it already. It's if we are reading what ISIS is producing or listening to it, we will hear many names, many Saudi scholars, many Salafi scholars, some older scholars. It's not only Ibn Taymiyyah, there are many more. So if you are reading fatwas from ISIS, and if you're reading fatwas from any scholar from Egypt, from Saudi Arabia, it's very difficult to see a difference. It's quite the same modern style of religious discussion that's happening, and that's, in this case, we might call it appropriated or whatever, what's used by ISIS. And if we are looking beyond the Arab world, I don't see anybody else than some the Indonesians who are saying, okay, they are using our religion and we do have a problem and we have to solve this problem. I'll come back to it. Just to summarize this idea, it's if we are following ISIS, reading ISIS, listening to it, we will see an organization working to create what it's a kind of textual archaeology. They are digging into the Islamic traditions, trying to find every instance that justifies their idea that Islam has to be violent. That's what they are preaching. That's what they are showing us, etc. It's Islam and violence that goes together. It has to go together. So we have to talk about theology, for sure, in this context. Coming to Iconoclash, whatever. So it's since I would talk too much about these issues. If we look into the acts of vandalism and destruction of cultural heritage, ISIS and other groups are doing, it's Al-Qaeda everywhere, it's, for instance, Al-Shabaab in Somalia. There are groups in Sudan destroying graves, etc. Al-Qaeda in Yemen destroyed graves, but it's ISIS that's famous for it. If we are looking into these acts of vandalism, we will easily detect all of the elements I mentioned before. ISIS, we might say, is not attacking human heritage in general. They are destroying Palmyra, Tadmor, Mosul, Hatra, etc. They are doing it for sure. But what they are doing much more is destroying other sites. They are blowing up Shiite mosques. They are blowing up Shiite graves, pilgrimage locations, etc., etc. Shrines who are venerated by Shiites in Iraq, in Syria, are destroyed all over. Do the media talk about it? The Western? No, not really. A few instances, so there are exceptions. As you know, we've heard a lot about the destruction of Palmyra. Okay, that's true. But did you hear about blowing up a very famous site close to Palmyra in Tadmor? Called a mazar, a kind of location to be visited, to get some baraka from it. Yeah, I'm afraid nobody heard about it. I sent you some pictures. Nobody is talking about it. It reminds me that nobody is talking about the hundreds of thousands of Muslims being killed by ISIS. If an European, an American is killed, okay, that's interesting, that's news. If thousands of Arabs are killed, no, why? It's usual over there, so don't bother me with it. We might say, who is talking about Tadmor prison camp? Do you know about it? The literature emerging from the Tadmor prison, the prisoners hold in detention over there, it's depressing, really depressing if you read it. But nobody is talking about it. So why? And that's what ISIS is building upon. They are showing, okay, we have destroyed this prison camp. We, nobody else. Not the West bombing Syria. They were not interested. So to some extent, we are playing into the hand of ISIS. We don't remember that, for instance, in Mosul, the shrines of some prophets have been destroyed in 2014. So Prophet Yunus, Prophet Georgis, and we don't know that ISIS has published a short tract justifying it, giving an Islamic legitimation to it, saying, okay, that these shrines are invented. Scholars invented the idea that let us visit these shrines, and if you are praying there, you'll get some positive effects on your life, etc. ISIS has said that's an idea created by scholars, by Islamic scholars, to get some money out of it, quite simply. So ISIS is telling these shrines have to be destroyed to purify Islam, to create a pure Islam. I'm coming back to this purity, this idea of purity. A true Islam, and the only one that's existing, it's ISIS. But we may show, just as a contrast, something else. There's another Islam existing. Don't be afraid, it will change.
Kedatangan Islam sama sekali tidak menimbulkan penolakan, tidak menghadapi penolakan dari masyarakat Nusantara. Karena peradaban Nusantara ini sendiri telah terbiasa bertemu dengan berbagai macam keragaman dari tempat asing yang datang, sesuatu yang baru, dan kemudian mereka mempelajarinya. Kalau suka diambil, kalau tidak ya dibiarkan apa adanya. Itu sudah menjadi langgam hidup masyarakat Nusantara. Dengan keadaan masyarakat Nusantara, peradaban Nusantara yang seperti ini, para pendakwah Islam kemudian bisa lebih tenang melakukan dialog dengan realitas setempat, realitas masyarakat setempat, dan realitas sejarahnya, sehingga menghasilkan ekspresi-ekspresi keislaman
yang mencerminkan substansi dari Islam itu sendiri. Saya katakan seperti ini sebagai perbandingan misalnya dengan peradaban Islam yang tumbuh di Timur Tengah dan anak-anak peradabannya seperti Persia, India Barat, dan Asia Tengah, dan ke Barat sampai ke sepanjang pantai utara Afrika sampai ke Maroko dan menyeberang ke Spanyol. Di sana, di dalam peradaban Timur Tengah itu, ketika Islam dikembangkan dari Hijaz kemudian melebar ke wilayah-wilayah di sekitarnya, yang terjadi adalah penaklukan militer sebelum pengenalan kepada Islam itu sendiri. Jadi,
so just not to occupy the podium too long, just to show, okay, there is existing another form of Islam. So just leaving the Arab world for a moment. And we have to look at Islam, extremist Islam, from a global perspective. We have introduced new points of view. And this guy who was talking is the political secretary of the largest Muslim organization worldwide. I'm talking about an organization of 50, 60 million people. So it's just a little bit, but it's a certain influential organization by now. So what's left to me? Once again, and okay, I think I'll finish by speaking as a white European man. I'm not allowed to teach. I'm an Orientalist. Orientalists are infamous for telling Muslims how to believe in Islam. So it's a traditional task. My professors did tell me, oh no, that's not Islamic. So you don't know, you're Assyrian. you don't know anything about Islam. It's me. So that's what I had to learn. I'm as a white European man. And I'm not talking about religion, but it's simply from my position as this kind of man. It's one thing left to us, and that's why I'm joining Nadia. It's supporting, and at least for at first, accepting agency of Arabs, of Muslims globally, supporting it, not trying to dominate it. I think it's quite sure, and Nadia has demonstrated and we might stress it's a global phenomenon, that Muslims are trying to create an alternative to extremist Islam, from political Islam to jihadism. And that's this kind of alternative Islam has to be based in its own history. That's what the Indonesians are doing. And to end with a certain optimistic view, our Indonesian friends, we are running a project together, are teaching us, so we don't accept anymore these white men telling us what we have to do. Okay, we are running a joint project, but don't tell us what we have to do. Okay, I'm as a head of the project, I have to say, I'm the administrator. Sorry, there are some rules to follow. And we are trying so to create a new, let's say, global dialogue that tries to overcome this colonial situation. And I thought, I'm convinced only overcoming this colonial situation will help us to fight ISIS. If this colonial situation disappears, they will disappear. And that's what happened in 2011. Al-Qaeda was silent, otherwise, no, even not talking about Egypt, his home country. And so that's what Nadia was telling, maybe the best weapon against extremism. And let's listen, try to support, not try to dominate. And build a new heritage. That's all. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I need to sink in the information. I think everybody else here needs to too. This is remarkable.
According to time, I'm going to ask a few questions so that I can also open it up to the audience. I'm sure everybody else has a lot of questions too. We saw a lot of counter narratives from each one of you. Why aren't they being heard? Why aren't they being supported? Why do you think?
Because there's an audience among their peers. But the West is not paying attention, but fellow young men and women are paying attention. This is, you know, everybody was surprised by the Arab Spring. Where does this come from? You were not paying attention. You were being spoon-fed by regimes. It's me or Islamist. You were not paying any attention. You would not even contemplate the possibility that a third choice that is not violent, that is not Islamist, and that is not dictatorial is being fostered. And the same thing is happening now. We will be surprised by this avalanche of creativity that is changing the entire Middle East slowly, because there's not comfort. But it doesn't matter. We can be in denial in the West. We can say, well, it's not really, it doesn't fit how we think it should be. They're Islamist. That's more authentic. Or secular, authoritarian, so we're going to negate it exists. Or it must be, you know, no amount of millions can convince you that this is actually really tangible until there's a big thing, and then it will be a surprise again, I think.
Any comments?
I think if you think about the relationship between technology and social change, if you're looking at this as an example, I mean, when we look back to 5 years ago now, of course, you know, Twitter revolutions and Facebook revolutions made the West feel very good about itself. This was technology that we had, like, you know, given to people. Like, our gift to the world is, you know, Instagram, right? And the problem was that the rhetoric of social change, when it was quick, when we thought it might be quick, was very sexy, and it fit very well into a media narrative of young Egyptians overthrowing the government. The problem is, democratic change is a long-term, painful process that takes decades. That is not a media narrative, right? What we're seeing up here is everyday satire, everyday communication, not people in squares throwing rocks, not tanks shooting
not
people.
The black and white.
This is black and white everyday life, and that doesn't fit into that particular narrative. So if you're asking about support, at least in terms of exposure, my initial response is, this is probably extremely interesting to journalists in London and Stockholm, but they're not going to cover this thing. Because the thing is, like, well, you know, why would we cover this? Like, what's going on? Where's the exciting?
Is it not sensational enough?
Well, no, it isn't sensational enough, right? Because social change is usually not sensational in that way. But, I mean, I'm just thinking about the relationship between what we looked at 4 or 5 years ago, and then it stopped. When the revolution stopped, or what we in the West thought as the, which really irritated people when that we said that, right? The revolution's over. Okay, so we're all going to leave now and go back to our home countries. The problem was the everyday life of building social change really was like, that's where the real engagement had to take part, if you look at Egypt. And that's where we left. And I say we, and I say as a European citizen, as an American, we left. And I think that when you see videos like this, we don't see videos like this in large part because it's too banal and everyday, and we're just not that interested in it. And it's exactly this kind of politics that makes social change. And I mean, of course, that's the mistake we're making. I mean, from a journalistic perspective.
I might even add that I'm remembering an Egyptian friend who was telling me, okay, I was going out to the streets when the internet was shut down.
Yes.
So if the revolution is taking place without the internet.
Deliberately without the internet.
Yeah, at that
dangerous
moment. So right. It's prepared on the web.
Yeah.
For
sure.
How do conflict media, arts, and culture shape our social identities and from what we've been seeing? And is history being remapped because of it?
I think you're better qualified.
Well, you know, I am actually studying something. I hope I'll have the time to write about it. Speaking about identity in the Middle East is the rise of originism. So you see, for example, in North Africa, we're not Arabs. We're originally Amazigh, in the Levant, where we're Assyrians. We're not really Arabs. So there's identities are being reshaped in part because actually of ISIS, because ISIS is unearthing the so-called pure Islam. Even their flag is actually designed by the Prophet, black and white. So they say, well, okay, this is you, this is your identity, fine. We have a different identity. So this is enabling a lot of diversity that didn't actually exist or was allowed to exist this freely in the Arab world before. Because when you were in the public sphere, what is the public sphere? When I was in school, you're not allowed to ask, you're not allowed to question, you're not allowed to raise an issue that is not comfortable or, you know. But when you're online, nobody is there to smack you, don't go there. And you can really let your imagination and your curiosity and identities, people are educated, people are actually learning their history in the Arab world for the first time ever. And texts are becoming available, historic texts like Ibn Khaldun, like if you read it, you think, oh my God, who's this? This is not what we're told he wrote. This is a whole different narrative that, you know, like the conquest, very ugly and enslaving. So identities are absolutely being rewritten and history is rewritten. And history, as my generation studied it in the Middle East, the history that the next generation will say will look completely different because of this space.
Yeah, I would like to add it. Even if ISIS is blowing up these sites, the shrines, etc., I think it's the young generation will build it up again. Yeah. So they won't win.
Yeah.
And I would also say that to bring these two questions together, the imagery that ISIS is spreading, I mean, that reaches us in Europe and the United States. The images that you're showing do not reach us.
Yeah.
And if I may be so blunt as to say that the images that ISIS spread serve a certain political function in Europe and the United States as well. It serves an interest.
Yeah.
So there is invested interest in that particular version of Islam, as we're noticing in the United States and as we have been seeing in Europe with Syrian refugees, that fits a particular rhetoric.
Okay.
When you get complicated images, it complicates that rhetoric, and I think that it tends to fall there.
Because weapons is a huge part. I mean, the U.S. and is inundating the Middle East with weapons. What do these weapons do? I mean, so, yeah, it's much simpler to keep the narrative black and white.
I have a question, Rudy, and of course, Nadia and Christian, you can always answer, but throughout history, how have the religions of the world been manipulated politically, and and how does protecting how does protecting this is from what I read from your digging in how does protecting and preserving history and heritage today safeguard the future of countries like Syria, Iraq, Somalia, Tunis, Yemen? I can keep going.
Sure, I would like to remind us, we had some years ago, I don't remember the exact date, an attack in Tunis, in Tunisia, in Jerba. So everybody was talking about, so they were attacking the pilgrimage site, etc. But I think it's the Western media, and I didn't, at least the European ones, didn't get the idea that what's Al-Qaeda at that time was attacking was a site of pilgrimage where Muslims, Christians, Jews were meeting. A kind of hybridity of this kind of diversity meeting and existing in real life. That's what they wanted to destroy. Mm-hmm. And I'm quite sure now we are seeing an emerging new feeling of diversity. So the Berbers are talking by now, writing in Amazigh. For sure it's difficult. I do have a Moroccan friend who was saying, okay, 200 years we were Arabs, then 100 years we were Berbers, now we are Arabs again. So let's see next year what's happening. It's not a stable identity. It's every day new created identity, and that's not interesting for journalists. But I think it's this knowledge, deep imbued knowledge of diversity that makes the Middle East, that makes the Muslim world, will resurface again and will be able to create another idea of what does it mean living together as humans. And that's what we are trying to elaborate on our project. The Indonesians did ask us, okay, we are doing research into, we are thinking about establishing a new online presentation of our form of Islam and creating new online networks to build an alternative to extremist Islam. And they are busy trying to make contacts in the Arab world, in Europe, etc. So it's, I think, in some way, it's the time of preaching back to the Arabs, sorry, but to a certain form of Arabs preaching the world. So we are seeing a change, and maybe we should listen to it.
You know, if I may comment, I really see a very, very powerful desire to be part of humanity, as opposed to this labeling narrative of us versus it's them, the infidels. So, like, the Saudi video, it's like, well, I learned in the U.S. Like, all of these, they don't, like you said, it's ISIS is the old and us versus them and clear distinction. And really, the most rampant space among Arabic speakers is like, I don't care. I don't want to have this narrow identity. I am a human being.
Exactly. So I guess this is a question for all of you. What does it mean for Western media narratives to be so obsessed with Daesh or ISIS or ISIL, they call them whatever you want? Hasn't so much coverage of Daesh played a role in amplifying their value and actual power, especially in Syria and Iraq?
I mean, yes.
Yes.
I can't speak to Syria, and I can speak here, and I can speak in Europe. Mm. Absolutely, and that's the point I was making previously was.
Exactly.
I think this real concentration, and this is, you have to make a distinction between an outrage at the violence you see and the ways in which the balance and coverage and the way in which it's contextualized. And I mean, we can see very clearly how that information is used in politics and in everyday life. And I mean, is it fair to criticize and preveen violence? Absolutely. But it's a question of representation. And I mean, this is, as media researchers, it's one of the most dominant issues that we have. It's like, you know, to what extent is what we're seeing representative of the group that we're looking at? And obviously, I think that, and this is where they have been so skillful.
Yeah.
They have appropriated, exactly as Rüdiger was pointing out very clearly here, they've appropriated the symbology, the visual style, and the slickness Western popular culture. And it is tailor-made for media that just eats it up, I would say. You know, absolutely eats it up. And I think that even the sort of, we're not going to show this video, is itself a kind of, like, you know, sort of self-congratulatory thing. Like, we're above this kind of stuff, right? And which, I mean, should television programs show a beheading? No, probably not. But on the other hand, they go as far as they can go. And then there's the question of that we see similar in the shooting of the on-air shooting of the journalists in the United States, where, you know, the camera was like a GoPro camera. They were using the New York Post, I think, or New York newspapers had that image. Well, I mean, what's the line then?
Yeah.
I mean, ISIS is essentially using the same kind of stuff that these sort of shooters are using in the United States. So I would say absolutely it's had an impact.
But I think there really is a selection bias. Because, you know, like the song I showed you, it's really well done, right?
Mm-hmm.
Or No Woman, No Drive. It's very funny. It could easily be a 1 minute segment on CNN, and it's funny, and it's... But I can't tell you, for example, as somebody who is from the biggest tribe in Jordan, my tribe goes back to the time of Moses, and my parents have fifth grade education, and so I'm as authentic as they get. But I can't tell you how many times people tell me, well, Nadia, but you're not authentic enough, because you're not Islamist enough. You're not... So you don't fit how we think you should be. So, like, there's a bias where the selection is, well, this is how the Middle East is, and they want to fit you in that box. And if you're a human being, no matter how authentic, father, grandfather, great-grand, but you're not extremist enough that you really match how we think we should be.
Mm-hmm.
And you should be Islamist or religious or Muslim. You know, there are thousands, and I'm happy to send links, there's one in English actually, of people saying, I don't want to be Muslim. I am not Muslim. I never believe. Online, there are millions who are probably silent about it because we live under authoritarianism. And if you have no right to leave Islam, so you're killed. But there are thousands who are saying, if the choice is either I'm Muslim or I'm killed, I choose to be free. I choose to, it's my freedom of conscience as a human being, it's my innate right. So, but this is, it doesn't fit what the West already decided the two boxes for us are.
Did you want to say anything, Rudy?
So I think in terms of media mainstream media, I'm remembering one case, an interesting case of a 14-year-old guy who got interested into Daesh via newspapers. Yeah. So they must be interesting. They're talking about it. Fine, let's look at the internet.
Cool.
It's cool. So I check it, etc. And he got some way recruited then. So it's just normal media that are doing the job of ISIS.
Yes, exactly. That's the point that I was... just to be fair, I'd like to actually open it up to the audience because of time. If anybody... I think the mic is in the back. Would anybody like to ask any questions?
Testing 1, 2. Hello.
Yeah,
I just want to comment. I've been in the news biz for a long time, and there's a couple, I think, misconceptions or things that are a little incomplete here. One is that only social media or new media can be propaganda, and that the Orthodox press is somehow this steady hand that keeps the gate in the proper way. In fact, the U.S. media has been pro-war for most of its existence. A New York Times reporter flew aboard the Enola Gay to drop the atomic bomb on one of the Japanese cities and basically participated, sitting in the co-pilot seat. And there's the history is pretty sordid. There were the Pulitzer and William Randolph Hearst newspaper wars that virtually caused the Spanish-American War. And in fact beat the drums that Spain was responsible for the bombing in Havana Harbor when that was never proved of the battleship Maine. And so although the ISIS thing creates a hot potato and a lot of problems, we don't want to get the conception that on the other hand, the Orthodox press is this august body that's going to, you know, be a backer of peace and a rational mind. And in fact, they are the ones that exploit and use the ISIS narrative to help the military-industrial complex in the United States. So ISIS becomes a useful enemy for the Western powers and the Western media that generally, as I say, backs warfare and backs the idea of U.S. imperialism and backs the idea that the U.S. must police the world forever. And I don't believe that's right. Plus, the other thing that's missed in all of this is terrorism can be carried out by militaries, too. Terrorism is not monopolized by jihadist groups.
Yep.
Virtually any war is an act of terror in the final analysis. And much of Iraq has been wiped out and hundreds of thousands of people are dead because of the U.S. military, not because of ISIS or any other group. ISIS came later as a reaction to all that, be it good or bad. So we have to look at this as objectively and broadly as possible. I thought the gentleman, Mr. Christensen, might address this.
If I gave the impression that I disagree with you, then I've done a grave injustice to myself.
And I know that from last night's dinner conversation.
My point about gatekeeping was that the function of selection has shifted. How that function was utilized and still is utilized by editors was something I did not address. My point was simply that the images that we used to see in the 80s and the 84 bombing or from Munich, that responsibility and that duty lay at the hands of editors. And that is something that has been shifted a little bit. But I completely agree with actually both of your points here. And the notion that, and also the notion that these are august bodies, there's also a very tight interrelationship, and we should stop separating social media and mainstream media. Mm-hmm. They are the same thing.
Their
traffic is driven almost entirely through social media. And I, you know, as a researcher, I hear this all the time. I get my news from social media. What? Like somebody on Twitter? No. You're linking to the New York Times. You're reading The Guardian. You're reading the BBC. I go to Facebook for my news. Is it Facebook? No, it isn't. It's the same news organizations you read before. The platform is different. And so, of course,
this very tight relationship between user-generated content, this kind of issue. It's a symbiotic relationship. They haven't figured out how to monetize it properly yet. But to make a long story short, yes, I agree completely.
Thanks. This is probably is a follow-up, and it's a follow-up to you, since you have lived in Turkey for four years and mentioned it. I haven't seen any manifestations. I don't expect it from our politicians. I don't even expect it from our State Department. But how about from our journalists? Any manifestations of responsibility to take Mr. Erdogan to task for the reign of terror he is in the process of expanding as he expands his autocracy, as he expands his, forgive me, Hitlerian mode of operation? Having spoken about that sort of responsibility, you used that word, and Nadia, I think, also used that word several times. What is the responsibility of the media to take that to task?
The same responsibility that any journalist has in any country, which is when power is abused, that that is exposed and questioned as openly as possible. I mean, Erdogan is now, if you follow the news from Turkey, he is now discussing making journalism and politics itself terrorist, or, you know, related to terrorism. So you can charge journalists with acts of terror simply by reporting on, for example, the PKK in Turkey. And so I think that foreign journalists have been pretty vocal, probably more so than their domestic counterparts, just out of fear. But I see it the same way as I see a discussion actually about ISIS and the sort of critical understanding of this. I mean, I find the discussion of ISIS that we're talking about, these terror images, to be incredibly simplistic. And so simplistic that it makes a really serious political discussion or social discussion about ISIS or these images of any value. I mean, really, it makes it very difficult. That's all I can say. I just think that, like all journalists, they have a responsibility. I think it's been done. I mean, I'm seeing people doing it, but the situation there is extremely serious, and it's getting worse on a daily basis. But I would point out that, you know, well, no, I'm not going to point it out. But I would just say that the situation in Turkey was brewing for many years before the AKP came to power. This is not simply a question of the AKP. Media was weak and destabilized. Unions were broken years before Erdogan came there, in large part in a power grab for money. So they sort of made their bed, and when Erdogan came to power, they had to lay in it a little bit. And so it's a double-edged sword, and I would like to get back to that notion that it's not simply a question of law and regulation, it's also a question of political economy. Journalism that's weak, like in Turkey, it's not simply weak because of repressive regimes, which it is. It's also weak because their organizing power and the economic power of the journalists was weak to begin with. They were ripe for the picking, let me put it that way. And I think that's always important to think about. It's not just regimes that come in and take over a strong journalism. Erdogan came in and took over and overpowered a very weak journalist corps.
I guess I meant our journalists.
Yeah.
Turkey is a necessary ally.
Yes.
The Europeans are flirting with him to join the EU.
Yes.
He's done everything.
They're making deals with him.
To scut that idea, yet they're flirting with him on that. Our journalists.
That's the best place to call it out, I would say. The negotiations between the European Union and Turkey for keeping Syrian refugees in Turkey in exchange for free flow of people and money. Yeah.
Yeah. Good trafficking, almost. Any other questions?
I lived young in Egypt, and I've been there as a journalist before, and I go back and forth, and I get disturbed and saddened that the people were so excited about the revolution. I go now, and it's either they've left, a lot of people have left, or people are afraid to speak out because you risk your life, I've been asked to go back and report, and I've said I don't want to do that. So I guess your thoughts on just, you know, what about the fact that that people are afraid, and there's a physical, I mean, there's people in Egypt, you can be physically eliminated, so less so I think in Jordan, certainly in Syria, but so what is the solution? I mean, to call on people to continue to protest, but at the same time. And then I also wanted to add, I just read this book that was done, all this reporting in Iraq, that part of the reason people have turned to ISIS is not because of Islam, but because they're so sick of this corrupted regime that came after the fall of Saddam, that's better than, you know, they see at least ISIS is offering a change, something different from this regime that came supposedly elected, you know, free regime.
So, you know, on your last point, Maliki did massive amount of damage to Iraq's Sunni population, which already turned against Al-Qaeda, but he practically handed them over to ISIS, unfortunately. But the issue of fear is real. This is not, I mean, people there, there are, I think if the region was free, you would see phenomenal renaissance, oh, yeah. Phenomenal. So this is happening despite the fear because there's, I mean, you are trapping 400 million people under these authoritarian regimes, which we support. They're mostly our allies. We still give weapons to Sisi, even though he is, you know, ensuring another revolution just because people can't eat. And there's a responsibility in the West. The West needs to look at its own responsibility in creating a little bit of space for peace. So the Middle East, for example, there's a phenomenal research called The Economics of the Arab Spring by an Oxford scholar, and his name escapes me now. But it's the place where it's the hardest to start a new business. So there's a lot of entrepreneurship starting, and it's you are less likely to be able to have a business in the Middle East than anywhere else in the world. So why is that? And if you have a business, you're more likely to have more stability and you don't want to... I mean, these regimes are terrorizing the entire globe. They're holding it hostage. But they're our allies. Don't touch them. And let's give them more weapons. So...
And that's great peace in the Middle East.
But the fear is tangible. There's no... I mean, this is promising, but the fear is absolutely there. And you don't hear about all the activists who are jailed, who are... But there are enough people that are not giving up. They're not calling for protest. There's really recognition, I feel, and a discernment that what we need is not to topple these regimes. What we need is more people who are educated enough, not official education, but who understand these values of pluralism, secularism. Literally, like, there's videos of these kids teaching what does secularism mean. It's not what the regimes tell you, your 14-year-old daughter having sex and stuff. Secularism means you are free to believe whatever you want or not believe. The state doesn't impose. ISIS imposes one version of Islam. The state imposes another. You have no say in either way. So secularism is you choose what your spirituality is because that's your innate right. So these kids are educating one another silently. I mean, again, I love to give this analogy that a million trees growing do not make as much sound as bullet, but they make a forest.
So you'd say the fear has been broken.
Huh?
The fear has been broken. There's no way of going back.
Among many.
We'll take one more question or no more questions. Okay. Thank you.